Morning. stand up.
Oh, well, I get that.
Glad you're all here this morning. We're going to add a new song in this week. This next song is called My Story. And it's a newer song, it's a little tricky, but the words to this song just speak to me as a congregation. Ian and I were just talking about the nuts and bolts of this song. Now, this is my story, this is my song. My story is a story. So we're going to sing, do the best you can, follow along, enjoy the work.
I told you my story.
piano player hiding in our midst for quite some time. And she told the story here that she rarely plays much, and her son asked if she would play him a song one night. So she played Thy Word for him, and what, 5 minutes later, I sent the songs for this week, and it was Thy Word included in there. So God laid it on her heart, and she had it up.
Starts at 10.
So we'll have more info as it gets closer to the lineup. That's next week. That's next Saturday. No, Tuesday. You know, I don't know why they let me do the announcements. Garrett, you're up next week.
Make sure we're all alert.
To see who's paying attention. I'm going to let you read through all this stuff here, but there's a lot going on. We're glad you could join us. Birthdays this week. Happy birthday today to Mark Lowry. There you go. There he is. Happy birthday. And this week, Jewel Cox, Mike Wavell, yours truly. Happy birthday. Anniversaries today. John and Emily Workman. How many years?
67.
Wow. 67. And also happy anniversary today to Charles and Jamie Hunter. Glad you could be here with us this morning. The pastor is on his phone. Coming. Are you on Facebook right now? Well, he's coming up here. Again, happy anniversary to John and Emily. They have done so many things for this church over the years. They continue to support this church through a lot of changes in the last 5 years and three, respectively, including me. And we're so glad you guys have been a part of this church for so long.
And Emily, you will be voted into sainthood. You are quite a woman.
Yes.
Yes. Yes, she is. Amen. Married to John that long. And you thought you had a problem. Yes. What I was trying to find, there is a fundraiser for the food pantry with Wednesday the 7th. All proceeds to the First Baptist Food Pantry, 5:30 at the Elks, for the Empty Bowl Ice Cream Charity Event. $3 scoop option of bowls may be made by the Girl Scouts. We'll have cookies too. I'm excited. Ice cream and cookies. Amen. 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 We hadn't been announcing it, and it's this Wednesday, 5:30 till 8, I believe it is, somewhere near. And what I want you to do is that, I know that you've ate your dinner by then, stop it. Let's support someone that is supporting us. Amen. Amen. And that's at the Elks. The goodness of God. The goodness of God. Amen. Overwhelmed by His goodness. It's good to have you here this morning. As we go to prayer this morning, let us be mindful of just how good God is. I was talking to a brother and he said, I'm busy. He said, you don't know, but I'm busy. He's talking to me. Who isn't? But there are things that we have to watch out for because we can get so busy doing stuff that we miss out on what God has planned for our lives. We were talking to a young couple in the back there about getting together because it's so important that we pray for one another, that we begin to lay a plan where we're going with this walk in Jesus. See, we can get busy going all over the place and still not get anything done. And I'm the king of that as well. But we need to steal ourselves sometimes from the busyness of life and get quiet before Him who is able. Sometimes we're working so hard on trying to fix things that we forget about the fact that He is the only one that can fix your fix and fix it forever. And so, as we go to prayer this morning, maybe there's been something that you've been dealing with in your life and you've been trying to fix it, and it ain't working. You're tired of being tired and you're about to give up on it. So I'm telling you today, Jesus is your answer. And He is wanting us to begin to believe Him and trust Him for our lives. I know that some things come and they're overwhelming. We don't have answers for, get tired and frustrated. Prayers don't seem to be answered. But I'm just telling you, as long as you got Jesus, you got everything you need. He's greater than your circumstance, your situation. He's able to hold you. And the Word of God says nothing is able to separate you from Him. Nothing is able to snatch you out of His hand, and He's greater than every circumstance, situation you are facing. The Word tells us that He's our peace. Maybe you just need peace this morning, along with your joy. Maybe this morning you just need to know that things that have been broken, He is a repairer of brokenness. And He is able to make us whole. Maybe your prayers have not been answered as quickly as you'd like. But I'm just telling you, it's right around the corner. It's right around the corner. And so, and you say, Pastor, how do you know that? Because if you don't see it on this side, you'll see it on that side. It's right around the corner. He is able to meet us in every circumstance, situation of our life. Sometimes, you just need to steal away with Jesus. Instead of telling Him all about your troubles, I'm just going to ask you to steal away for a little bit and begin to just praise Him for who He is. Begin to just thank Him for His simple things. He woke me up this morning. He started me on my way. To begin to just praise Him for what we've been saying. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. That we begin to just thank Him for the many blessings that He's poured out upon us. I know that some of you may be going through hard times in a relationship. And I'm just going to say to you today, you just need to do this one thing. Pick out that one thing that he does, she does, those kids do, and concentrate on it. And when you begin to look at the good thing, you'll find out all those bad things aren't near as bad as what you think. All I'm saying is that God is our answer, and He is our strength. As we go to prayer, what do you need Him to do in your life this morning? What do you need Him to do? See, I know that He's able to hold us and keep us. I know that He is our strength. I know that He is God in our life. But what do you need for Him to do for you? Is there a prayer that you just need for yourself? You've not told anybody but Him. But this morning, I believe that He wants to bless you. God, I know He does. If you'll just put it out there and say, Lord, it's in your hand. And I guarantee you the peace of God that goes beyond our understanding will fill your hearts with His comfort and His peace. And so this morning, this is a day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we come before your throne this morning. We thank you, Lord, for this day that you have made. We thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning, starting us on our way, Lord. You are God all by yourself. There's none like you in all the earth, Lord, and so we come to rejoice in you. We come to thank you, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, for all that you have done, doing in our life. We were lost, but now we're found. We were dead in our transgressions, Lord, but you have made us whole and alive in you. Let us rejoice today at this great salvation that you have given us, Lord. And then, Lord, the word tells us that you have prayed for us. You've held us. You've kept us. You've guided us, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, because if you had not been there for us, Lord, we don't know where we'd be today. Lord, I pray today, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that we would see you, Lord, as a miracle worker, as a God of peace and comfort, a God that is able to take the brokenness of our lives and make it whole. Lord, I thank you today that you'll restore, Lord, our broken dreams. Oh, Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we as people, as your people, Lord, we begin to just trust you, Lord, whatever circumstance, situation that we find ourselves facing. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, for our families. Lord, I pray, Lord, I lift up families to you. There are sons and daughters, Lord, that are far from you. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that they will remember, Lord, that they have been taught. That they would open up their heart to you, Holy Spirit, as you begin to nudge them and woo them back into yourself. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, for that mate, Lord, that is not walking with you, Lord. And I pray this morning, Lord, that they would be restored, Lord, or come to know you as a personal Savior of their life. Lord, I pray this morning that we would not pray as those that have no hope, Lord. We have hope in you. And so, Lord, I thank you today for the joy that you give. Lord, I thank you today, Lord, that we can pray here and cause things to happen out there, Lord. I know there's somebody facing a mountain this morning, Lord. But, Lord, you can say to the mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, Lord. There is nothing too hard for you. With you, Lord, all things are possible. Let us believe today that our thinking can be transformed, Lord. We don't have to stay in the rut we've been in, Lord. You are greater than our ruts. Oh, Lord, teach us how to love as you have loved us, Lord. And teach us, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, to walk as we walk in this faith with you. Lord, I pray this morning. I pray for those on our concern list, Lord. I pray for them, Lord, that are in the military overseas, Lord. I pray that you just watch over them, keep them, draw them closer and nearer to you. I pray this morning, Lord, again, as for those that are in the hospital, Lord, those that are in the Father, Lord, Alma's son-in-law, Lord, who's still at the OSF, Lord. I lift him up this morning. Lord, there's things going on in his physical body, Lord. They're thinking about, Lord, dialysis and all these different things, dear Heavenly Father, but you are a great God. I pray to Heavenly Father, Lord, not only is he alive, Lord, but he'll have life, Lord, and wholeness and healing in you, Lord. Let us believe this morning, hallelujah, for miracles, hallelujah, in Jesus' name, Lord. I pray this morning. I pray this morning, Lord, that we would not be afraid, Lord, to put it all out there before you, Lord, and then put our trust in you. Lord, you raised the dead, called blind eyes to open, Lord, the lame walk. You, dear Heavenly Father, spoke to the to the storms of life, Lord, and they calm. And so, Lord, what we bring to you today, Lord, is not hard for you. But I pray this morning, Lord, that we would trust you, Lord, in this journey. I pray this morning, Lord, that we would see you, Lord, binding this nation together, Lord, as saints of God, Lord, pray to you. And ask, Lord, your mercy to fall upon us today. Be with our communities, Lord, our city, Lord, and this county, Lord, in which we live in. And I pray this morning, Lord, that you would use us as an outreach, Lord, to them that are lost, Lord, that they might come to the saving knowledge of Jesus. Lord, I pray this morning, Lord, that we would give you all praise and honor and glory, Lord, that we would not hold back from you, but we would worship you, Lord, in the spirit and in truth. That we would believe you today, dear Heavenly Father, that you're going to do mighty things, not only in the body of Christ, Lord, but in our lives as well. I thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for the call, Lord, that you're putting upon your people, Lord. And Lord, and we're saying yes and amen, Lord, to that that you are calling us to. We will be a beacon, Lord, in this community, Lord. We will be an outreach, dear Heavenly Father, to them that are lost. And we will see them come to you, Lord. That is our prayer. That people, Lord, will come, Lord, and surrender their hearts and lives to Heavenly Father because we dare, Lord, preach the word, teach the word, and then live the word. Help us in our weakness, Lord, that we would be strong. Help us, dear Heavenly Father, this morning to be true to your word. Oh Lord, I know I've asked a lot of things, but Lord, is there anything that you can't do? And so Lord, I pray this morning. I pray, Lord, hallelujah, that those who have had strokes, Lord, will find themselves whole. Whole. Those with cancer, Lord, will find themselves whole. Dealing with arthritis, eye problems, hearing problems, unable to even walk. Find themselves whole in you. And so, Lord, in your hands, we put all this morning. And we believe this morning, Lord, that you hear us. And you are a greater Lord than the storms of life we face. And so, Lord, may we be bold this morning and say, peace, be still. And let us trust you, Lord, as we surrender our lives to you. We will give you all the praise, give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord praise. Time that we give back to him who's given so generous to us. And this morning we give our tithes and our offering. And God is a God that doesn't care about what you give. He cares about the attitude in which you give. He asks that we give with a cheerful heart. And that we would give to him in faith, knowing that he is able to do all that we have asked and hoped with our times and our offerings. As the ushers come and wait upon us, let us put that in the plate and with the joy of saying, Lord, I'm just believing you for great things for that. And then I'm just going to tell you, expect your windows to be open and that he'll pour out your blessing that will overtake you. Are you not ready this morning for overtaking blessings that are in the Lord? Amen. Amen. Ushers, would you wait upon us?
Thank you.
thank you now for the tithe and the offering. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that you give us, Lord, to give back to you. Now, Lord, we ask you to do what only you can, to take that, Lord, that we have brought before you and use it for the furtherance of your kingdom. Lord, we pray that lives will be touched and transformed, Lord, not only here in our county, in our state, our nation, but across the world. Lord, we believe in you, Lord, that because of the faithfulness of your people, that you will touch lives, Lord, and lives will be changed forever. And so we give you all the praise now. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Children's time.
Respect.
toys. What's something we should respect? Cats. Yeah.
Dogs.
Dogs. What? Farms. Yes. What do farms provide for us? They provide food, right? Babies, yes. And we respect our Bible, don't we? We read it daily. Caleb, shall we sit down? Thank you. Okay, let's all bow our heads and say a little prayer. Lord, we thank you for each of these young children. May each of us, children and adults alike, remember to show respect in all that we do and say. Amen.
Didn't hear Pastor Joyce has a red Bible.
That's right.
If you're not on the inside joke there, Pastor said you're supposed to have a red Bible, meaning you're supposed to read it. Joyce thought it was a red R-E-D. We're going to take communion this morning. We're going to sing the song called Communion by Third Day. Before we take the elements here, but I would encourage you to have a little time of reflection, a little time of preparation. You can sing with us, you can meditate over the words if you'd like, you can pray to yourself while we're singing. Pastor will talk more about it obviously here, but this is we do this every first Sunday if you're a visitor here. We take this very seriously. We are remembering the sacrifice that was made that gives us hope. It is the reason that we rejoice and be glad about every day being a new day. And we have hope in the ever after as well. So let's stand, sing, pray, meditate, whatever you choose to do here.
We
Those of you who are serving this morning, would you come? Michael shared this morning, this is our time to come together before the Lord, to remember the perfect work that Jesus did for us on Calvary. It reminds us of his death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, and authority and power has been given to him. The night that he suffered, the Bible tells us. And the teaching was that he gave to some, to his teaching, he said, to receive from the Lord that night, and Paul wrote that in 1 Corinthians. When the Lord Jesus was handed over to be killed, he said he took the bread and he gave thanks for it. There is a reminder of his body that would be broken for us. Let us pray.
the Gospel of Luke, the Word of God tells us, when the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And it says he took the bread, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us eat. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we find these words. Again, on the night when the Lord Jesus was handed over to be killed, he took the cup and prayed. And so we now give thanks to the cup of blessing, which symbolizes the body and the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Let us pray.
As we come to the communion table, let us be reminded that through Christ's blood shed on the cross, that we were forgiven of our sins.
Thank you.
After taking the cup, Jesus gave thanks. Take this and divide it among you. And I tell you again, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And in the same manner, Jesus taking the cup, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shared for you. And when you drink this, do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray.
My life.
and I asked him to be God in my life, I remembered that peace that came over me. And I knew that he was doing such a thing in my life that I wanted to live for him. And when I said that, I meant it. Maybe you said some things to him that you met, but then somewhere along life's journey, storms rise. There was a storm that had been rising in my life at the time when I asked him to be God in my life. I wasn't getting born again. What I was doing was saying, Lord, I surrender. Have you ever come to a surrender place in Christ Jesus? A place where you said, Lord, I can't do it on my own. I need you. You've been trying to do all you know to do, but it just seems to be falling apart. You've been praying and praying and praying and praying. I remember one time I went and talked to my mom. I said, Mom, I'm struggling. I'm struggling. I don't know how to do this. And she said, as she does, baby, pray about it. What did she think I was doing? She had taught me how to pray. I remember them taking us and kneeling down by the couch in the afternoon during on a Saturday or a day during the week, and they prayed with us and taught us how to pray. So I was doing that, but nothing was happening. My frustrations in life had begun to just build up in me, and I didn't know what to do. I had done everything that I knew to do, but nothing was working. Have you ever been there? I've been trying to get it right. I've been trying to do everything, but there arose a storm upon my life. I remember a time when I cried out to God and I said, Lord, why are you doing this to me? And I felt the Spirit of God speak to me and said, son, I am doing this to you. You're doing it to yourself. And what he meant was that I was trying to make right in my own strength, in my own understanding. And with that night, though, when I said, Lord, be God in my life, I was at a place of saying, I don't know how to do it. Now, just like he was with them in the boat, he was in my life. He was there, but I thought he was sleeping. I thought he didn't care. I thought I didn't matter to him. I thought that maybe that he was busy with somebody else. Somebody else needed him more than I. But I found out that he's never too busy for us. There is no call waiting with God. The line is never busy. You do not get music when you're praying to God. He heard my cry. And that peace came. And in my heart, I said to him, you'll have no more trouble out of me. Because I knew he was my only refuge. That he was my place of safety. I understood that. But like so many of us, somewhere down the road, wasn't immediately, I found myself slipping, not being all that it had me to be. And it wasn't because I wasn't desiring, I just hadn't grown yet, but I was growing. I was growing. But I found out that no matter what stage of life you're in, you still need Jesus. Because you get off track. You get off track, you get in places that you never thought you would ever find yourself in. And I thank God for the grace and the mercy, but the storms of life, I'm just telling you, they come. They come in forms of illness, they come in all of these things here. They come in times of life when you're not expecting it. Have you ever been up on the upside of life? Everything going your way, and it just sounds like that somebody took the rug and yanked it right out from under you and down you go. I remember talking to a young man who had made a commitment to the Lord and he was on fire. And then somewhere along the line, I didn't see him. Where you at? Where you at? Putting out fires. The word is busy. Putting out fires. But what God is calling us to is that he's the only one that can put out the fire. No matter how hard she tried to get me right, she wasn't able to do it. She bartered with me. If you do this, I'll do that. Lord knows she prayed for me. Sometimes she even hollered at me. And there were some times that she threatened me. I know I had to come. But what I'm saying is that no matter how hard we try, we can't change nobody. All that we can do is just begin to live our life out with Him in the midst of the storm. But until you come to a place of understanding of that in your life, you continue to wear yourself out trying to fix your fix. These men were in the storm. And the Bible tells us that there began to become a waves of storms, and the sea began to toss the boat. And it says that the sea was so coming up so high that it began to splash into the boat, swamping the boat, covering the boat. Now these men were professional sailors. They knew what they were doing. This was not their first storm. Sea of Galilee has many storms. But this particular night, this storm kicked up. See, sometimes in our life, we have dealt with storms, but we know how to fix them. We know what to do. I know exactly what to do. You know how it is. You've been in this predicament before. Your month is a lot longer than your money. Things are running short. You've been able to figure it out. Circumstances, situations. You haven't been all that you ought to be. But you know how to fix it. Some candy, some flowers, or some Starbucks. But one day we find out that even that doesn't work. I don't want any more flowers, I don't want any coffee, and I don't need any Starbucks. What I need is the storm to steal. I need the storm to get quiet. I need something different. I'm tired of this going on in our lives. And so there they were. The storm had begun to sink the boat. And in the midst of that, of them doing all they knew to do, they said, "Where's Jesus?" The Bible tells us that they said he was down, he was sleeping. He was sleeping at the end of the boat. And they were looking around, "Where is Jesus?" See, I don't believe that they got up all of a sudden and said, "Let's go get the master." No, they were in the midst of trying to keep this boat afloat, and they're saying, "Where's Jesus?" You said that too. Where are you at, God? Where are you in the midst of my sickness, in the midst of my struggle, in the midst of life circumstances that are coming my way? No job, no place to live. Things come all the time in our life. Lights being turned on. Gas turned on. Water bill. Water turned on. Got babies in the house. These things come upon us. I hear them every day. These things come, and the question is sometimes, where are you, Jesus? But they're not looking for Jesus. What they're doing is that they're continuing to do what they do, and they're just saying, "Where you at, God? Where you at?" But somewhere along, somebody came to the senses, and it said they went to Jesus, and they woke him up, and they said to him, "Save us." Oh, what a great prayer. I was looking at that text and I said, those people know how to pray. Because see, they didn't use any fancy word. They were in a situation and they needed help. And when you need help, you don't have time to say, "Oh God of heaven and creation, how great." No, you need help. Help me. And sometimes it's just Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. But if the Word of God says that He knows our moanings and our groanings, and if you get real in your heart and realize you're in a place that only Jesus is able to save you, you will go and get the Master. They went and they asked that question that we asked. "Lord, wake up. Don't you care that we are perishing? Don't you care that I'm going through storms in life? Don't you care, Lord, that I can't fix this?" See, I believe that there's times that God has to let the storms come so we get to a place of understanding we can't fix our fixes. We need Jesus. He woke up and he asked the question, "Why are you afraid?" Now, this is what Jesus saw. He saw the same thing they were looking at. The waves were pounding, the rain was coming down, there was thunder, there was lightning, the waves kept coming up over the ship, and Jesus said to them, "What are you afraid about?" The waves were not just coming up, but now he's standing in water like the rest of them. The boat that was sitting high above the water now is sitting right at the edge of the height of the water. And Jesus is saying to them, "Why are you afraid?" we've been talking about for the past month. Don't be afraid, but believe. The word tells us that Jesus said to them, let's get in the boat, we're going to the other side. He laid down because he knew what he said. He fell asleep in the midst of the storm because why? He knew who he was. He knew where he was going. He knew what reason that he came. Jesus was going to die on the cross, not in some water on the Sea of Galilee. He was in the boat. The promises for children of God is that we will be with him. We'll never be left alone. And if we leave this life, we'll find ourselves in the presence of him. And the question when your storms are coming, when situations are in your life, why are you afraid? He said, oh, you have little faith. Little faith. Now, he was not talking about that they should have prayed about, in the name of Jesus, peace be still. But what he was saying, you got me. You got me and your circumstance and your situations of life. Why are you afraid? Why are you not able to be bold in me and trust me in this thing that you're finding yourself dealing with? Had a time talking with my brother Ray. Caterpillar was laying off. And they were cutting back. And he said to me, he said, brother, this is some of the three of the hardest days I've been through. But he said, God will provide. And I reminded him, you might have thought when you put your application in that it was you that got that job. You may have thought your qualifications from your past and your military background and that you've been a supervisor here and you've done all of these things that it impressed Caterpillar. Well, I'm just going to tell you right now, there's a lot of people got resumes that don't get hired. But by the grace of God, you did. See, I want them to be reminded that God's got you, and that's what we were talking about. God's got it. God's in control of your life. You don't have to worry about nothing. If he's a provider of one job, he's a provider of another job. God's got it. And that's what he said to them. I got this covered. Why are you afraid? Why are you of little faith? And then he rose and he rebuked the wind and the sea, and there came a great calm. See, there's something about when you just reach out to Jesus, there comes a calm in your life. I told you about that night in the midst of the storm of my life. I said, God, if you are God, I need you to be God in my life. And all of a sudden, there was a peace in my storm. Now, the messes of life were still that I had created was still going on. All the junk that I had created was still going on, but I had a peace in my life. See, that's what God does. He doesn't have, first of all, he doesn't start on the stuff. He starts with you. And with you, he begins to give you a peace that goes beyond your understanding. Mama's sick, daddy's sick, all these things that we deal with in our lives. But God is saying to you, there's peace in the midst of your storm. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. He dealt with the stuff later on that I have been dealing with in life. But first of all, he dealt with me. Do some of you this morning need Jesus to deal with you? To give you your peace, the joy that only he can give, the comfort that he brings. Do you this morning need a Jesus fix for your life? See, I talk to people, talk about anxieties and this thing and that thing in their life. And what they really need is just some Jesus. Just some Jesus. You say, oh, Pastor, it can't be that easy. Oh, I'm just saying. It was easy enough for him to say, peace. He didn't have to shout. He didn't have to point the finger at the storm. All he said was, peace, be still. And the calm came. And see, he is wanting to say peace to our life. But we haven't even got to the part of the message. This is about the fact that Jesus was in the boat with them. And then when the calm came, and it said it was a great calm, what it meant was that suddenly everything that was in a mess just got quiet. It got quiet. And then the men marveled. They marveled. And they said, what sort of man is this? Even the winds and the sea obey him. Now, I thought that was peculiar. But when I was looking at the miracles of Jesus, the first one that John records is that of the wedding of Cana. of Galilee that they ran out of wine, and Mary got Jesus. And she said to him, they ran out of wine. Jesus said, what does that have to do with me? Doesn't say that it says anything else. Then she turned to the servants and she said to them, whatever he says do, just do it. Oh, I thought that was such a great word. Mary said to the servants don't even know what's going on. Jesus said to the servants, I want you to go and get those earthen vessels, water pots, that had been shaped out of mud, molded out of mud. They were earthen vessels. He filled them with water, told them to fill them up with water. He said, now, take them up there and give them to the governor. Now, these men had to be shaking in their boots. Sandals, excuse me. They took the pots up there. But first of all, Jesus said to his mother, woman, what does this have to do with me? And what he was saying to her was not being disrespectful. He said, the time was coming that one day I am going to fill these earthen vessels with some new wine. Why are you bothering me with this? But he did it. Told him to take it up there, and we know what the story says. It says that when they gave it to them, that the governor reached in and he took the ladle full and he tasted it. And he said, normally, people send the best stuff out first. And then after people have been well filled, then they bring out the rock gun. Bones farm. I'm dating myself. Muscatel. He said, but you have brought out the very best at the last. What we say was that Jesus did that miracle. There had to be talk that happened later on, but it says yet at this time that the men were marveling at what had happened. It tells us in chapter 4, and we read about it, about that Jesus had done many miracles when we were talking about the woman being healed with the issue of blood. We read that text. That the word had gotten out that Jesus healed and many were healed. And Matthew told us that. And then also in chapter 8 of Matthew, that it also says there was a leper that was healed and cleansed. That Jesus found himself that in the midst of situations and circumstances, there were them that have been an unclean in their life. Someone that he should not touch because he is a minister. In fact, the Old Testament says, and the law says, that if you touch them, you become unclean yourself, and you're not able to minister. But Jesus told us about the law. He said, I did not make the men for the law. I made the law for men. And he let us know that he was the creator of the law. And when it came to taking care of the leper, it said he cleansed the leper. Matthew 8 went on to tell us that he met a man who was a centurion. And the centurion said, my servant is laying paralyzed at home, suffering terribly. He says, and Jesus said to him, I'll come. And he said to him, Lord, I am not worthy of you coming under my roof, but only say a word, and my servant will be healed. For I, too, am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to them, go, and they go. And I say to them, come, and they come. He said, do this. And he does it. And when Jesus heard this, he marveled. He said, I want you to know that the man marveled at Jesus, but Jesus also marveled at men. He marveled at this man, it says, because he had never heard anyone have such faith. So then I began to get curious. I said, Lord, then what is this marveling thing going on? I understand when men marvel, but now it says that Jesus marveled. It means that something wonderful had just happened. It means that something astonishing has happened to a person or a thing. That a wonder that had never been done before, a miracle, a sensation, a spectacular thing, a phenomenon. All of these things said something about marvelous. It has something to do with that they marveled at this situation. It said it's an active word. They were filled with wonder, filled with astonishment. They were amazed. They were surprised. They were in awe. And Jesus marveled at the man that was there, and he marveled because the centurion said, all you gotta do is just speak, and he'll be healed. They were there for that. They knew that there was power in the word of God, and yet when he spoke to the winds and the waves, they marveled and said, who is this man? I would have thought they had said that when he said, take the water up there and let them drink it. And I know they had to be sitting back and going, I can't wait to see this. And when it turned into wine, they said, did you? But then it says that he healed the leper. Surely they had to marvel at that, because nobody had done that before. Maybe, but we know that the Old Testament, that Naaman got down into the water. But it had been 400 years since the word of God had been spoken, nothing been going on, and they saw this for the first time. They should have marveled. But then it says the centurion was there, and Jesus just spoke a word, and that servant was healed. It says in fact, when Jesus heard this, he marveled. Truly, I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from east and west and recline at the table of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the sons of the kingdom will be thrown in the outer darkness. But Jesus was saying, there will be some who have not been part of church stuff, and they will get it. And there will be those in church that will let it go by. And see, I'm just saying today that it's the time that we get marveled. Should we be marveled about the things of God and what God is able to do in our hearts and in our lives? Should we not be marveled at the awesomeness of God and who he is? It went on to tell us that. And the centurion said to Jesus, and Jesus said to him, go and let it be done for you as you have believed. And the servant was healed at that very moment. Surely they would have been marveled at that. And then it says, he went to Peter's house, and his mother-in-law was sick. And Jesus just saw her. She was laying there with a fever, and he touched her hand, and the fever left her. Surely they would have marveled at that. And it says, in that evening, they brought to him many who were oppressed by demons, and he cast out the spirits with a word and healed all who were sick. And this was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. And he took our illness and bore our disease. Should have been marveled. And then I thought about, Lord, I've been marveled. In fact, I asked the person, I said, have you ever been marveled? And the person replied to me, said, I was marveled once. I said, well, tell me about when you were marveled. I was going through some things. My life was heavy. I was wondering where God was at. I was driving in my car, and I said, Lord, where are you? Let me know that you're there. And in the midst of the darkness, the sun broke through and began to shine on me, and that light was with me until I got home. And they said, I marveled. I remember when Anita was sick, I remember a time that I was heavy in my heart, and nothing was happening. She was laying there paralyzed in the hospital, and many didn't think she would live. And I remember driving on 24 coming to get the kids. I said, Lord, where you at? It was raining, it was pouring down, and all of a sudden the rain just stopped. And in the midst of the clouds, the sun came through the window. I knew he was there. I marveled at a time when the rain was coming down so hard, so heavy. You've been in those kind of rains. The wipers couldn't take it off. They were going as high as they could, and you still couldn't say nothing. And all I said was, Jesus, help me. And the rain stopped immediately. I was marveled. I was marveled another time that when we were going to coming from the hospital in Springfield, Anita and I, she had been down for some tests. And being like I am, there was no GPS at that time, but being who I am, I missed my turn, and I stopped on the road, and I pulled over so I could turn around. And I looked in the rearview mirror, nothing was coming. I checked my side mirror, nothing was coming. I hit the gas, I turned the wheel, and an 18-wheeler went by my car just that fast. The car never moved. It never moved. I didn't say anything to Anita right away. The semi went by, I turned, and on our way back home, I said to her, "His angels watches over us." I don't know what happened in that moment. All I know is that the car was in drive, I hit the gas, I turned the wheel, the car didn't move. The word of God says, "Angels watches over us." I was marveled. All I'm asking you, have you ever been marveled in your life? That's what this word is about this morning. Jesus has come into our life and he wants to marvel. He wants to bring us to a place of understanding that God does these great things. And are you watching? Are you paying attention that it is him that does it? It is him that provides the jobs. It is him that touches our infirmities. It is him that gives us peace in our life situation. It is him that heals us of our pains from our youth. It is him that heals our hearts from our pains of our lives. It is him, and it is him. And when you have that joy and you look at your life and you begin to say, "I'm in a good place today, and who would have thought that I would be here, or you would be here, that God would be doing these things in your life, and that even in the midst of your circumstances of life, we still can praise him in the midst." Do we not marvel at the goodness of God? They said, "Who is this man?" Even the wind, the waves obey him. Who is this man? The Bible said he is the giver of new life. He is those that the forgiver of sin. The Bible says that he took our iniquity upon him. The word of God tells us that he will be a father to the fatherless. He is a comfort to the widower. The word of God tells us that he is the one that is able to take the brokenness of our lives and make us whole again. The word of God reminds us that he is the God of peace and the God of joy. The word of God says he's the God of comfort. The word of God says there's no weapon that is formed that's able to prosper against us because he's an almighty God. The word of God reminds us that he's the beginning and the end. All power is in his hand. The word of God reminds us that he is greater than any circumstance, situation you ever find in your life. That he is able to keep you. He is able to put you into a new place if you'll put your trust in him. They marvel, but my question is, have you been marveled? And if you're not, is it time that we be marveled by God? See, there's things you may be facing today and you're wondering, "I'll never get past this. I had a person say my life has been so bad for so long. I'll never be able to outlive this." But I told them, if you'll just press in, then yeah. They said, "You don't know, Pastor, you don't know. My life has been a mess. I've been a mess." And some even told me, said, "I've had a breakdown. I've had all these things." I said, "But will you trust him? Would you trust him?" And all I'm telling you today, if you will trust him, he will be God in your life, and you will be marveled. That's all he's asking today. Will you trust him? If you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, I'm going to ask that you would come this morning because Jesus still forgives us of sin. If you need prayer this morning, I'm going to ask that you would come and we will pray with you because there's power in prayer. If you desire to be a member of this church, we'd ask that you would come this morning as we stand and sing "My Still Way." Story, you will hear. continues to rebuke the storms of life. We want to thank God this morning that Robert Smith came forward and to become a member of First Baptist Church. Amen. We've known of Robert for several years, and we know that God has done something mighty in his life. I'm finding him to be a man of his word. Talked to him a few weeks ago. He said, I'm coming. I'm coming. I'm coming. And he's been coming. Bible studies. He's seeking. He's looking. And then he said to me just this week, how long have you come a member? I said, well, if you just come forward, we'll get you done. So, Robert, I need you to look at me. I know you know the Lord as your personal Savior. Yes. And you desire to be a member of First Baptist Church. Now, Robert, I need you to turn around and take a look. Now, I'm going to ask you again. Are you really sure that you want to be a member of First Baptist Church? In this life, we're going to have some storms. They're overwhelming. But Jesus is in the boat with us. And he says, peace to your storms. Let us believe today that we have him in us. And it doesn't matter what we're going through. He is there. And he cares about the things that go on in your life. You matter to him. You matter. So, Father, we thank you now. And I pray this week, Lord, that we will be marveled by who you are, the forgiver of sin, the giver of new life, our hope for today and our hope for tomorrow. You're greater than our past, and you're the God of our present. And, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for tomorrow that we will see it, because, Lord, when we get there, you will be already there. I pray today, Lord, and ask, Lord, that you do, Lord, what only you can do. Families are looking for miracles, and you do miracles, and you do them well. So, Lord, we're going to go by faith. We will not doubt. We will believe. We'll not be afraid. We will believe. And we will exalt your holy name and give you all the praise and give you all the glory. May your comfort be, Lord, with the comfort of us. And may our joy be overwhelmed, Lord, and be filled because of your presence. Now go with us as we go from here. Meet us, Lord, as we travel this week, Lord. In the busyness of life, Lord, may we find that you are God who still says, peace, be still. Now touch us. Go with us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shake somebody's hand. Tell them you're glad they're here today. Amen. Amen.